website, there is a link on my gifted website. If you're interested in being part of the UPC gifted committee, I know they're always happy to have folks join them, talk about different concerns and ideas. Like, they help plan all of the meetings that we have. Melissa, would you like to say anything about you?
Sure. I'm Melissa Schwartz, and I'm the president of United Parent Council. Does anybody know what United Parent Council stands for? Are any of you members of United Parent Council? Are any of you members of your PTAs? PTOs? PTSAs? Okay, so each of the schools, we have 43 schools in our district, and each of those schools, or most of those schools, send representatives once a month to the United Parent Council. So we get an opportunity to talk not just about one school, but about things that one school is doing that can help another school. And that's certainly helped it in our gifted program, because we've been able to share, just as the teachers do, the parents are able to then share what's going on and how different programs are available. And that's part of why we provide these programs on a district level, so you can find out more about those opportunities. But we do this about all sorts of things. We have a gifted committee, we have a special ed committee, we talk about scholarships, we talk about planning for your child going to college. What are the different steps that you might be looking at, both in gifted programming and regular programming? So please check out our website. We are live today on our Facebook page. It is UPCPVUSD at Facebook. So you'll be able to find us there. Thank you.
Can you say that one more time?
Yeah. UPCPVUSD. Okay? And we will save this video. And there are videos from many of our other gifted programs. Dr. Belgian and DJ Graham have both, we've recorded both of their presentations. So feel free to take a look at them at your leisure.
Okay, so raise your hand if your child has just recently been identified as gifted. Okay, that's what we do this time of the year, because of our big spring testing that we have going on. We will be testing until May, so some of you might be here waiting for your child to be tested, so it's still good information for you. So today we're going to talk about what that gifted identification means and how that relates to our services that we have in Paradise Valley. I'm going to talk a little bit about our teacher training and support, because it's a critical part of our program. As a matter of fact, that's one thing that sets us apart from other districts' gifted programs, is the depth of training and support that we provide to your teachers. And then just some other news items that were places for you to seek out information, and I'll share that how I've compiled some of that. Before I do, we have our small staff in gifted ed. Aside from me is Karen Brown, is our gifted program manager, and she is there to support the gifted teachers. We have a gifted cluster coach who's there to support the gifted cluster teachers. By support, I mean providing resources, training, anything that they need to become more comfortable teaching your gifted kids. We have our gifted data technician, Deanna Sherverdian. So some of you have talked to Deanna. She is a whiz with our taking care of all of our rosters and making sure everything gets into our system appropriately. So some of you may have talked to her about testing. And then Kim Adams is my admin assistant, and she's the one that's primarily answering the phones, directing you to different places on the website, answering some questions. We are here to support our teachers and to serve you. So do not hesitate to take a look at, to give us a call after you've looked at our website. It's very expensive. Deanna keeps updating that probably every day, I would say. And then we have our gifted testers, which each of them are retired gifted teachers, and they each have a bunch of schools that they do the testing at. So we were really, really proud of our system, and it keeps evolving as we get more new needs of things that are going on. So let's just start off by talking about the gifted testing, because this is a lot of you just experience this right now. And sometimes I get a call from a parent that says, something's wrong with your test. My child is a straight-A student, and he didn't pass your gifted test. What's wrong? So there's no pass or fail to a gifted test. You qualify prepare for one of these tests, it's because it really, they really test potential, ability for being able to learn. So whereas the achievement test really tests what your child has learned, probably at school or in a classroom at any given point. So they're very, very different. There are many gifted students who are not that straight A student, unfortunately. This is why we have gifted education programs, because these kids think differently, they learn differently, and sometimes they're not gonna reach their potential unless we do something differently for them, and that's what we need to identify. Our goal is to have all of our gifted students doing what those bright, really strong students that get straight A's are doing, to help them achieve at levels commensurate with their ability scores. So when we talk about these tests of general ability, if you've got a report from us, you probably saw it said verbal, quantitative, and nonverbal. That's just the construct of the test item. It does not relate to how the child thinks or learns. There will be children with more strengths in math if they're identified in a quantitative test or battery. There will be students with more strengths in reading and writing, who may be history, if they're identified on a verbal construct. The nonverbal area crosses over to how the child thinks and learns, how they process information, how they make relationships and ideas, how they make connections and insights is really what it means to be gifted. So even though the contents of the questions differ for verbal, quantitative, and nonverbal, it does not mean that different abilities are being used. And this is why I really wanted to talk to you about this, because if I see a child is identified as gifted, period. Verbal, quantitative, nonverbal, one area, two areas, three areas, I don't care. It means that they have high potential. And I'm gonna do everything I can to reach them. And that's why we group these students together in cluster classes. And that's where we have content replacement. Yep, excuse me, I've had the allergies going for a long time. So when we talk about general ability is really what allows people to solve problems, to approach learning in different ways. It could involve all these things listed here. Reasoning, memory, sequencing, drawing inferences and making connection, and working and analyzing simple and complex ideas. Where in that definition does it say advanced reading or math? Nowhere. It's how they process information across the board. So that's why we group them together, teach the teachers how to help develop that high potential. And then when they get into the fourth grade, then they can start content replacement with a gifted specialist, and that's accelerated math and reading. So I'm going to go through some of those programs so that you can try to see what the best fit for your child is. When we look at the gifted identification, I'll see if you can see this. So look at, shows too late. The gifted identification really identifies students who are 2 to 3 standard deviations from the norm. So if you look at the norm being 0 on that chart or 100 IQ, and you move 2 to 3 standard deviations, you're going to see between 130 and 145 IQ. That's where the vast majority of our gifted students will be if they had an IQ test. We use ability tests, which correlate with IQ, but are not the same thing. I'm going to show you another chart that's going to help you see it differently. The one thing I want you to look at on this chart, so I'm seeing 2 to 3 standard deviations from the norm, right, on the right side. Look on the left side of that bell curve. 2 to 3 standard deviations from the norm on the left side, and what do we have? We have students with some special learning needs, and we have a lot of supports in our schools for that. We have special ed teachers, resource teachers, coaches, a lot of support to help those kids. But in the classroom, it really relies on what the teacher is doing if you look at the other end of the bell curve, right? So that's why it's so important to group them together. And then we have a go-to person at every grade level to give the training to. That's the general program that your kids would be identified in. If you took the gifted test, we put your child's name is on the roster. And then when we go to make class placements in the fall, we will group all of the gifted students into one classroom at the grade level. at each school. So that there might be four, there might be 14. Yes, it depends on the school and the grade level. Truly, we keep identifying more and more as the years go by, so our cluster classes for kinder or first grade will have fewer, probably than the fourth and the fifth, because we continue to identify students. Another thing I want you to take a look about on this bell curve is if you look at the left side, the first side where the kids have some struggling going on, they also, you know, the further away you are from the norm, on the back side of the curve, you're gonna have different social emotional needs that other students might not have, other affective concerns, right? The same thing holds true to students who are on the right side of the bell curve, because the further you are removed from the norm, different social emotional needs that you're going to have. So that is a very big part of our training with of our gifted teachers. I'm going to share with you at the end some sample workshops and topics that we focus on with our teachers so that you can know the type of training that we're trying to provide. The other thing you'll notice is that there are many faces of giftedness. If I asked each of you to describe your child, I'm telling you, you would have slightly nuanced or very different descriptions of your gifted child. We know that. We get that. So these kids are going to have different needs, but they're also going to have, and those needs manifest themselves in different ways. A lot of that is also dependent on what, you know, the child itself. Sometimes we have that creatively gifted child who really thrives in music and art and kind of, you know, straight line on and academics. So when I'm going to try to get teachers to identify students for to nominate for testing, I want to look at all teachers. Art, music, PE, orchestra, I mean, all STEM, all of the teachers, not just the classroom teachers, because some of those teachers will see strengths in their child that the classroom teacher might not. Highly confounded gifted children, they need a different route. We're going to be going through some of those. Culturally and linguistically diverse students, I work very closely with the ELL department, the language acquisition department. I work with the testers, the language acquisition testers, every single year. And I train the ELL teachers. Why? Because they're going to see things in students that they work with that the classroom teacher might not be seeing. I work with the school psychologists and the special ed teachers, because when they're doing meetings for IEPs or case studies, something might come up where the child has some issues in some areas, but really high in other areas. So we want to catch all of those kids and enfranchise them so we can develop the potential of all of our gifted students, not just those high-achieving ones that the teachers readily see, okay? Does anybody know any non-productive gifted students? Actually, I know a few. And there's a reason why they're non-productive. Because maybe they're not being challenged by the classroom work. Maybe they're just limited. They don't want to invest time in something they already know. Maybe they're non-productive because they have a teacher that doesn't really get them. So there's a lot of reasons why, but those are the students that concern me the most. The students who have high ability that are not yet achieving. I'm gonna go over with you somehow we collect some of that data so we know what populations to target. And then the twice exceptional gifted student is that child with an IEP for special ed and a gifted identification. If they don't need a self-contained, self-special ed classroom, then they are in our gifted programs. They are in our cluster classrooms. They are in our constant replacement, and they are in our self-contained program if that's what they need. So we look at the students very individually, and that's why I work so close with the special ed department as well. So another way of looking at that IQ chart, where I said 130 IQ is around where most kids are identified as gifted, maybe 125 to one, you know, around but there. It's really basically about 3 in 100 students. And then when we get to 140, okay, but when we get between 140 and 115, 160. So think about this. Think about the last time you were in an event or a place where there were 10,000 people around you, right? How long do you think it would take you to find somebody like you, somebody that thought like you? It would probably take a long time. This is why we group students together, so that they automatically have peers and kids that can connect, that they can connect with, and they don't feel isolated or ostracized or made bullied or made to feel like you're a nerd. It's a good thing being a nerd, especially when all the nerds are together, you know? It's a good thing. We want to make kids feel good about themselves, and that's one reason that we group students together. So when we talk about high ability is related to how students learn, they make relationships between things and ideas like that, really unusual ones. I'm sure you've heard some of your kids come up with some things and you're like, how did you get to arrive to that? What made you think of that, right? And then they'll tell you, and like, it makes sense. Would any other child come make that connection? Probably not. So you can see the benefit of having them in a class together, it's because they spark those ideas. They learn very quickly. They do not need to spend as much time going over the same the work. They don't need 25 problems when they can do the five most difficult first and then move on. So we teach teachers how to do that. And then, of course, they can learn more advanced content because they're processing information at a different rate, but also on a different level. So that's why we have to, let me give you an example. Say we're teaching something about the Civil War. And we want our students to learn about battle sites and dates and victors of whatever battles and things like that, right? The kids can look at it. Sometimes read the passage, got it. I don't need to spend as much time. So we might have that small group looking at some of the social, political implications that led to the battle at that site. And how did that compare to another report? So that we use the same content, but at a much deeper level and more complex level so that they can analyze information in a different way that more suits them. So, some people will say, why do we even have gifted programs? What do they need that other kids don't need? Actually, they need exactly the same thing as all kids need. They need consistent opportunities to make academic growth every day, every week, every month, and every year they're in school. And unless we group them, train the teachers, and do something different with that curriculum, they're not going to make that growth. So that's my disclaimer when people say, well, I don't know why we have gifted programs. They learn differently. They don't need to go through the same sequential steps. And you know how schools lay out, right? Step one, step two, step three, step four, everything in a very linear sequential way. And how do gifted kids learn? How do their brains work? A to M to Y, hit a wall, go back to G, move forward to N, okay, I'm done, right? They're more abstract thinkers, and that's not really how school is designed. So that's just another thing to look forward to. So let's talk about gifted programming. Dr. Barbara Clark out of UC Berkeley, decades ago, identified some critical elements of gifted programs in the book that she wrote, Growing Up Gifted. This book is now in its ninth edition, and these elements are still prevalent. Our models that we have in Paradise Valley address all of these critical areas. Cluster grouping addresses them all immediately. So we need to flexibly group our students because they all have different interests and strengths, right? And they have different background information that they're bringing to the class. So we form flexible learning groups within the classroom based on the kids' needs. We know they need differentiated instruction and curriculum because they're learning outside of the average. Continuous progress. By this, I mean that we need to know where they're at before we know if they're learning, right? I mean, if we don't give pretests or diagnostic testing prior to instructing, we might not know that the child had already mastered 90% of those standards or that content. So what we teach teachers how to do, the cluster teachers, give the pretest first, then use those results to form your flexible learning groups. That way we can make sure and then we can document that the gifted students are making progress. We know that kids need intellectual peer interaction. They thrive off working with other kids that are similar. And continuity means that gifted education does not start in fourth grade when the pullout starts. It starts as soon as a child is identified. And we have services from preschool through high school. I'm gonna go give you a very brief introduction to all of those. And none of these programs are going to work if we don't provide teachers with specialized training. So I'm going to also touch upon that. This is a statement that came out of one of the big programming book guides, and it says, there's no single way, best way, to develop programs for gifted students. They're so varied in their interests, talents, and abilities, and learning styles. So programs must be flexible, dynamic, multi-level, designed to meet individual needs. And the goal is to expand students' abilities, not just to establish a program. So I have been in many, many districts as a consultant and helping districts develop their programs. And I think the biggest mistake most people make is they develop a pivot program and then they try to find kids that will fit that program. But we do the opposite. We identify potential in students and then modify and revise and add to our gifted programs to make sure we are including all of those different populations that need to be challenged at a different level. Seems pretty simple to me. So some of the program options that I'm going to talk about here, and I'll go through them very slowly, I'm going to put the list here because there's slides before that I just created. So look at that list. Most schools say, we have a gifted program, and here is what it is. What we want to say is we want to develop a continuum of programs because there's a continuum of needs that these gifted kids have. So I'm going to briefly discuss each of those because your kids might be anywhere from preschool to high school. Our gifted preschool we have at four locations. They're listed there. We do the testing for them through our school psychologist. You can call my office and Kim Adams, my admin, will schedule the gifted test for your preschooler. They can test anytime they're 3 and a half or older, and then they can enter the program as soon as they turn 4. So we have kids entering in October, in January, and in April, and a lot of kids will be with us for more than a year because of when they enter. So it's very age-appropriate activities. There is a drama table, there is a sensory table, there is the circle and the calendar. The difference is that, for example, they take everything that is a bit more complex. By November, they're all reading. They develop their writing at different times because a lot of that is developmental. But instead of doing letter of the week, they might do compound words or alliteration. Instead of doing color of the week, they might do tertiary colors. And in the body, instead of doing the skeleton, the kids draw a skeleton and then all the bones, they look at body systems. Instead of states of matter, they'll talk about how to transition from one state to the next. So it's taking all of those fun things that the kids at that age love to learn and just letting them go further with it because that's where they're going to. And then it is tuition-based because the state doesn't fund our preschools in Arizona. Tuition is $760 a month, and it follows the school year. It's pretty a low average of what a lot of the preschools out there that I found in there. So then we have gifted kinder, self-contained kinder, and this is at those same schools, but also at Sonora Sky. We're opening a self-contained kinder there for next year. And I failed to mention, with a pre-scheduled preschool, we need a 90% or higher in one area, and that's because it's really hard to accurately identify a three-year-old, to test a three-year-old, okay? And the scores only tend to go higher. So then a 97 is needed for the self-contained kinder, only one area for the self-contained kinder. Now, let me remind you, every single elementary school has a gifted cluster kinder class. But if you want self-contained kinder, it's at these five locations. And then we move on to what I was talking to you earlier about the cluster grouping model at every grade level, at every school. And so say you've got three kids at one school and you realize your kid is identified as gifted. Your child can be served at the home school. You don't have to like move kids or split up, you know, have two different schools. You can if you want to, but there are options at your home school for that as well. There are videos of teachers and students talking about the cluster model on my gifted website. Please visit that. There's articles, scroll down. There's a lot of information there. Scroll down and then there's links to articles that you can just print right from there. Some of them are for parents if you want to see the research behind this. Some are for teachers and strategies. What should I expect when I get the cluster teacher? Good question. there's information on that, how we form our classrooms. And then when they get to fourth grade, content replacement in every single one of our elementary schools, that's, they have a gifted specialist teacher in each of our schools who teaches the accelerated honors, math and reading, on a daily basis. So that teacher is the teacher of record. 95% of our gifted students are in the cluster and content replacement. The self-contained is where the other 5%, and that is for kids who are highly and profoundly gifted and radically accelerated. So remember that bell curve that I said most of them are between around 130 to 145? What happens when the child's over 145 IQ? I'm sorry, they do need something different than the regular cluster classroom if they are radically accelerated. I cannot make your child meet that program. You cannot make your child meet that program. Mm-hmm. There are many parents who want their children to be in that program, and let me tell you, it is a miserable experience for that child if they don't meet it, because it is very fast paced. First graders are doing third grade standards. Fourth graders are using sixth grade standards. So if you're wondering if this is a program for your child, go onto the AD website. Well, first of all, look at the information on the website. We have videos for this as well, and a lot of information. But then go to the ADE website and look up the Common Core standards for, if your child's in first grade, look at it for third grade. Look at it for two grade levels up. If that's where your child is, then you're probably going to want to apply for this program. Applications for this program are open right now. We do fill up at certain schools. So if you're waiting for test results and they do show, go through some of this information and then give us a call. We can let you know where there's still space available. When you apply for the self-contained, you do not apply for a fourth grade, the 3-4 class at Desert Cove. That's not what you do. You apply for the self-contained gifted program in Paris Valley. And on the application, there's five different the locations list in priority of preference. And we do everything we can to, one, keep families together, two, to keep you with your preference. And that even means that you will go. If your preference that you want Fireside is not available, your next choice is Desert Trails. We will give you a spot in the Desert Trails. We will keep you on the wait list for the Fireside. And when the space opens up, we will call you and say, you're welcome to move over, space opened up. 9 out of 10 times, the parents don't want to move when they get called because they made such a strong connection with the teacher and the school and they're happy there. So that's just a little bit about the self-contained and the differences between some of those. The uniquely gifted program is a collaboration between special ed and gifted. It's funded by special ed. They have to go through all the special ed laws, IDEA, which in least restrictive environment is attempted first. This is for the kids. Usually most of the kids in this program are on the autism spectrum, usually make Asperger's type of thing. But these kids do are uniquely gifted, and they have a teacher who has a special ed background and gifted training and an aid in that class. And right now we have it just grades 4 through 6. I think next year we're trying to go down to third grade. Usually that's when we find the kids that need it the most because we don't identify them too early on. I've been speeding through this, but I forgot to mention, after we're done, we'll take questions about the programs or identification or anything that I talk about in the presentation. If you want questions about your personal child, please call my office and Kim Adams will schedule a phone meeting with me. Okay. Digital Learning Center. Okay, so I talked a lot about elementary. What happens when they get into middle school then? We've got several options for that. This is the one where the most of the self-contained gifted kids go into, the Digital Learning Center, and that's because they have to have higher scores, just like the self-contained. I think it's two scores, in 97 or above, or one score with two in the 90s. It is technology-infused, it's project-based, it's integrated curriculum, it's problem-based and project-based. The kids do a lot of creating their own videos and a lot of primary resources. It's really complex and it's a beautiful environment for, once again, for that child that needs it. If your child needs structure and needs to know what page they're on, and when something is due, and how many words it needs, or all that, that type of a structure, that's not the program for your child. Once again, we have parent nights for this twice a year, and we also have tours. So if you're in fourth, fifth, or sixth grade, start looking for that. Start looking in advance. I guess that's why I put it this way. The extension from the Digital Learning Center, a lot of families go to the DAPS, and that's a Digital Academy of AP Scholars, and this is located at Shem Walton High School. And it's very different than the regular AP classes where the kids move from class to class. They're in kind of like a commons area, and the teachers move. So it's more, it extends that project-based learning at a higher level. Once again, if your child doesn't need it, then the regular gifted program at the high school is going to be better for them. Now, the other middle schools, we have advanced curriculum, we have honors classes at all of our middle schools, and this includes Pinnacle Peak Elementary School, which now has grades 7 and 8. So those students also have opportunities for honors in all of the subject areas, and then you also have STEM. What you should know about the middle schools, though, for the honors, is that it looks slightly different at every school. So what you would want to do is go onto the middle school websites that you're, say you're looking at Explore or Vista Verde. You're going to want to go on and see how the honors classes look different. At least some of them have more sections, or more subjects. But they all have math and reading, level math. Some of them have also honors social studies and honors science. Most of them do. We have the honors academies for middle schools, which are really awesome. This is run out, and this is applied application goes through Desert Shadows. It's an honors academy for pre-engineering, and then a different honors academy for world languages. They also have regular honors classes if your child doesn't want one of those specialized honors academies. Outstanding honors teachers in our district and at Desert Shadows. International Baccalaureate program, we have this K-12. We're one of the very few around the country and very few in the state. So PYP is called the Primary Years Program, and that is at Quail Run, and that is their entire school system built that way. Then when some kids get to middle school, they might want to do the Middle Years Program, and that's at Vista Verde. And then the DP is a Diploma Program, and that is at North Canyon High School. I encourage you to take a look at what the IB program is all about. It's a wonderful curriculum. It was originally developed for the children of diplomats whose parents had to keep moving around a lot, changing country to country. So it's a curriculum that's consistent. If you're taking it here or if you're taking it in Singapore, it's going to be a consistent, very high level. You do not have to be gifted to be successful in that, but you do have to be a hard worker. You have to be a highly motivated student. And universities really like to see that DP, diploma, the high school IB certificate on transcripts. They AP classes as well. The colleges like to see AP classes, of course. We have AP classes at all of our schools, and we even have some that are online. And that's because when you get to those specialized, sometimes you don't have, it doesn't fit in your schedule. If you also want to have orchestra and, honors Spanish, you're going to miss this class. So the kids can take that in the school during their school day. There's an actual teacher, even though it's an online teacher, who goes around and meets with the students. Honors online courses are available primarily in the middle and high school, but we have some. See, we have some fourth graders who are doing honors algebra. I'm not kidding. Every year we have a half a dozen or so. We make that available for them. We're not going to stifle a child. We're not going to put them to breaks, like a lot of districts do, to say, this is an honors class. You're in fourth grade. You get fifth grade honor. So I don't care if you've been maxed out of the fifth grade and sixth grade and then seventh grade. We are teaching fifth grade math in this honors class. I can't tell you how many times I hear that from other schools. We won't do that. We're not going to push your child to accelerate in an area that he doesn't need it, but we're going to provide opportunity if they do need it. So those are some of the programs. But you might be thinking, so what does instruction look like that's different from general ed? So I'm just gonna highlight a few of the strategies that are common in all of those different programs that I described. First of all, acceleration. I always say acceleration is one wheel on the bus for gifted kids. The bus isn't gonna go without it, but it's not an excuse for gifted education. Acceleration is part of the process, and we accelerate kids wherever they need it. And this occurs in all different classrooms. But we also want to flexibly group our students, like I was mentioning before, and we flexibly group in all of those different program models, okay? Because the construction, the instruction is going to be, is going to vary for the kids depending on what background knowledge they, and readiness skills that they bring to that content. And it might be that one day your child is working at a very advanced level, say they're doing a data analysis in math, and then next week you get into geometry and it's, oop, hit a wall, I'm not at the highest in that. So we want to make sure we're getting kids what they need, when they need it. Curriculum compacting. What do you think of when you hear the word compacting? Compacting. Garbage can, right? Trash compactor, right? What do? We smush up the garbage to make room for more garbage, right? So we do that the same thing with gifted students. We condense, we reduce the amount of time that they need to spend on anything because they learn more quickly than others. We compact differently for what information is new. They haven't been exposed to it. They're going to need less time. If they're compact, we give them a retest and we realize they already know it. Then we're compacting for known content, and then we're going to give them extensions of that so that they go deeper into it. So there's a lot of these. These are all the types of workshops and trainings that we provide our teachers on an ongoing basis. Critical thinking and enrichment are just the most important thing that we can provide to your gifted children. They think critically. They like to problem solve. They like to analyze. They go to much more depth and complexity. They ask why all the time. Why? Because there's so much more information to know about any one thing. So that's what we call critical thinking. We want them to think critically and to ask a lot of questions and never be satisfied with the answer that I say. I had a parent call me and said, I am so frustrated. My child comes home every day and says that the gifted special teacher won't answer the question. She said, that is just, you know, unheard of. Why? That's a teacher's role. And I said, she's doing exactly what she needs to do. As soon as they answer a question for your child, whoop, stop, and they're not going to go further because they know the answer. Well, Socrates says, you never know the answer. So the more we can challenge them at their levels and get them to go deeper into that content, the more they are going to learn. So I mentioned some of these workshops. I know they're all tiny and hard to see, but those are just, I just took one. Okay, so we offer workshops every Monday, Tuesday, and Thursday, pretty much year-round, fall and spring. I mean, usually after school workshops. And then in June, we have workshops the entire month of June, every day, a.m. and p.m. Teachers love to learn about these strategies, and they have more time in the summer. I advertise these out to all teachers in the district. I require that some of the cluster teachers attend cluster teacher meetings and take some of these trainings, but we want all teachers to have exposure to this because there's gifted kids in every classroom. Think about yours before he was identified as gifted. I want teachers exposed to some of these strategies, and it helps them get an interest so that when I have an opening for a gifted position or a gifted cluster teacher, someone can say, I've been to 12 workshops. I want to be that cluster teacher. So a lot of this information that I'm sharing like those with PD, that is on our gifted website. I'm gonna show you the link to that in a minute. But another thing in that you're gonna find, we do these parent newsletters quarterly, and a lot of the topics come from my meetings with the UPC gifted liaison, Mary Shigarity, and we sit there, okay, what are parents talking about? What information do you think they need? Those type of things. So we will try to get information. I want to provide you with links to resources that you might not have known about, webinars and other summer activities and other things that are happening in the Valley. There's a parent institute every October. Push that out. We want to talk to you about some of the training. That this is just good information for you to have. So if you see that, please take a look at it. Sometimes I'll highlight what a certain teacher is doing or what our gifted cluster coach or our gifted mentor is doing. Oh, the other thing, I archive those on the website. I'm going to show you where that is in a minute. Also from our website, sorry, this is an old date slide, but is a link to the gifted, the United Parent Council that I've been talking about. And on that, we have a listing of all of our parent workshops and seminars for the, and also Marisha will add information for her gifted committee meetings to encourage some of you to take part in that. So this is a snapshot of our gifted website looks like. We always have upcoming events posted there. We have our calendar. But most important to me, for you, is this, the parent link. So there's a link that says parent resources. Go to that frequently, like once a week, just check it out, because we do post new things there. If you want to go back and see some of our past newsletters, take a look at them. They're there. They're archived there. If you want to, Melissa was talking about some of these videos that we upload. We will, they're posted, they're linked there, some of them as well. And then when you're going through our website, if you have things that you're wishing that we had, please call us, let us know. Dina, like I said, we'll talk to you about that, and she'll either help you find where it's hidden, because there's multiple layers here. I'm asking her every week, where do I find this? Seriously, because it changes out. So there's a lot of information there. The other thing we'll put there is some of the ways that Paradise Valley has been in the news for gifted, and it is quite astonishingly a lot. So I have links to some of those things. NPR saw a story in a magazine, in a journal, the ASA, or American Association for School Administrators, because they contacted four or five districts who are doing a good job working with their ELL and diverse populations with gifted. So then they contacted me and said, can we come and interview some of your students? So they followed these two little girls around, and one was in fourth grade, one was graduating. Both of them were from these families that are monolingual Spanish, and they came to us not speaking a word of English. They both just thrive going through our gifted programs. So there's stories about that that you can see, some of the ways that we work with some of our culturally and linguistically diverse students. And like I mentioned, there's some other articles there that Karen Brown and myself have published, that people call us sometimes and say, hey, can you write an article about how you're doing this or that? So some of that is there. We would love for you to take a look at it so you can learn a little bit more about some of the things that we're doing. Strategies for Challenging Gifted Learners, this was in a different journal, an ASCD, which is an educational journal. Just a lot of different ways that we have been, our efforts have been highlighted. Karen Brown, August, this was one that I wrote. The role of gifted coordinator, what does that person do? And then always, if there's questions that you have when you're on our website, just shoot us an email or give us a call. We're happy to respond to that. So I just talked straight for 45 minutes, and now it's your turn. So I would like, we're going to turn off the camera because we don't have to.